be here enough.
Okay.
So, but before we hear Tansri speak, let us give a big round of applause for Macha! 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 Macam dari mana?
And I'd like to also acknowledge all of you here, but especially Dr. Mazalan Khamis, our immediate past CEO of Yayasan Innovasi Malaysia. And I see a lot of friends here, a lot of you guys. We are Yayasan Innovasi Malaysia. We were formed by the government back in 2008, we were operational since 2010, and our job mainly is to nurture and build innovation, particularly at the grassroots level. Jadi kami melihatkan inovasi bukan sahaja yang technical sangat, bukan research driven, but more on what's going on in the grassroots, kat kampung-kampung halaman kita. There's innovations everywhere, and that's the message that we want to bring to you. So, this event that you are at is called the Yim Teh Tarik Talk. As Hani said, this is our 9th installment, but the first for 2014, and we are very excited to have Tan Sri Shukor, whom I've had the privilege of sharing a stage with very recently, baru in December. Tan Sri, di Kementerian Kewangan and MOF, we were talking and discussing about innovation then for the Hari Inovasi MOF, and since then we also attended something quite amazing, and we're showing any of the photos of our visit to LHDN just 2 days ago. Adakah kita punya photo slideshow of the event 2 days ago? Okay, so never mind. Tansi will speak about what's going on in LHDN, but in my emails to you and in the invitation that you received, I had stated the key points. The key points being, just 3 years ago, 3 years and 18 days ago, now I know because he had an event 3 days ago, 3 years and 18 days ago, Tan Sri came onto the DG's office of Lembaga Hasil Dalam Negeri Malaysia. He transformed it totally, became the CEO of that organization. From the first day, he's telling me, his first briefing to the staff, he had introduce the song that you just heard, We Will Rock You. He'll talk to you about how that had garnered and galvanized the entire organization. And where we're coming from Yayasan Innovasi, our interest is bagaimana Tan Sri boleh mengembeling 11,000 people in Lembaga Hasil Dalam Negeri from a typical government organization. You and I have been to government organizations, to something extraordinary. You would not believe, if you've never been to LHDN, tak payah tax lah. Bayar kan? Bayar. Tapi bayar online lah sih, so dia tak payah pergi. Tapi kalau you tak pernah pergi, please go. You will not believe the type of officers you will see there. The staff of LHDN are totally amazing. You will feel a different vibe going there. So, think and I hope, harapan kami, this is the future of public service in Malaysia. This is where we're going, and we hope that people like Tan Sri will lead the way for a new and improved, you know, government service in Malaysia, better service delivery, you know, better satisfaction all around, and of course, better revenue collection, which he will talk to you about as well. As the Inland Revenue Board, his job is, of course, to collect from all of us. He's done it in a better way, a more efficient way. He's broken records every year that he's been the CEO of LHDN. And so that, in a nutshell, is what we're going to talk about today. We will have an opportunity to ask questions to Tan Sri. This is a very informal session. Kalau in the midst of his talk, you rasa nak menjerit, bertanya soalan pun tak apa, Tan Sri, kan? We've had that happen before. Somebody betul-betul tak tahan ni, nak tanya juga. Dia berdiri dan terus bertanya. During the talk pun tak apa. Tan Sri is not, like I said, your typical jusa, if I can say so. He's very approachable. When we saw him at the LHDN, you could see everyone from the police guard to the receptionist to the driver, semua berborak-borak dengan dia. He's very approachable and very friendly. So don't worry about asking him questions. I will start asking him questions now with a brief one-on-one session to chat with him a bit more on the personal side before he goes into his slides and talks about LHDN and what he's achieved there. So, without further ado, please welcome the loudest applause in the team for Tan Sri Siko. Apa khabar Tan Sri? Please have a seat or stand, whichever makes you more comfortable. Now, how are you today, Tan Sri? Apa khabar?
Saya sehat awam ya. Terima kasih saya ucapkan kepada Yayasan Inovasi kerana sudi menjemput saya berada di pentas anda pada hari ini. Apa khabar semua?
Hai! Thank you.
Okay, Tan Sri, yes. We'd like to start. This talk started off as a personal sharing session. Okay. If I've not mentioned it, we've had before Chef Wan, Jason Low, we've had a wide range of people. So kali ini, we are very fortunate to have you. And we always like to hear about bagaimana, how did you arrive here, and what is this your story until you became CEO of LHDN?
Okay, of course. Pada masa saya sekolah dulu, ini started with from the school, you know. Because kita realize that sekolah tu sebenarnya everybody yang melalui sekolah tu sebenarnya adalah penting. Masa kita sekolah dulu, we realize that we have a core curriculum. Yeah? Core curriculum. So when I was apa tadi form 4, saya tak detektif. Saya tidak detektif pada masa tersebut because I'm not a good sportsman. Friendly. Saya tak pandai main sangat. Memang begitulah tapi tak pernah wakil sekolah.
Sekarang nampak sangat fit.
Okay. So, at the end of Form 4 session, so I was called by my cikgu pada masa tu, dia kata, Syukur, we are going to appoint you as a head boy next year, dia kata, Form 5. Wow, saya kata. And being a head boy, dia kata, next year, you kena ambil 3 perkara. You must keluar nanti best student, you kena active in sports, and you kena active in persatuan. Okay, the first one tu a bit difficult lah because mana saya tahu I can be keluar sebagai best student lah kan. Active, okay, fine. So from daripada situ to me is a challenge for me lah. Jadi saya pun cuba, saya kata okay, I'm not a sprinter. But I try to get apa tadi, apa long distance lah. So I lari, jogging, everyday jogging. So finally, wakil sekolah lah tapi tak menang, it's okay. Wakil sekolah, tak menang, fine. So, masa tu saya lihat cikgu ni, dia very smart ni. Dia dah nampak sebenarnya student dia ada talent. Saya tak tahu yang saya ada talent masa tu. So, when he appointed me as a head boy. And then, wow, you know, head boy, form 5, man. You just imagine in 1972. Some of you belum lahir lagi, tak kan? In 72, it's a great man, tak kan? So finally saya cuba dan masa tu pula tu ada one of my teacher, dia kata dengan saya dalam ajar matematik, Syukur, dia kata kalau kamu nak pandai matematik, dia kata kamu kena main chess every day. Alamak, satu lagi cikgu sudah info. Kita cakap cikgu, kita percaya. And from that day I started learning pick up chess. Then I tahu bahawa chess ni sebenarnya lot of philosophy behind the chess. That's the reason in politics, pepatah Melayu kata percaturan politik. Mana dia kata apa tadi perdam politik? Dah. Nampak tak? Percaturan. Yes, I learn a lot of percaturan apa dalam catur tu tadi. That's the only game yang saya really go into it. Itu. Tapi saya ni pula satu, pada masa tu saya tak ambitious untuk masuk pertandingan, I'm not ambitious. Hati kecil lah masa tu, hati kecil je lah. Tapi main okay, no problem. Dan sekarang saya rasa Azif eh, bila saya dah dilantik sebagai CEO, I'm applying that management menggunakan chess game. Because in chess, a lot of things.
Strategy.
You must good in opening, you must good in your center game, end game. Nampak tak? Sometimes you need to sacrifice. Nampak tak? So a lot of things is better. So itulah basically lah. Itu yang menyebabkan, berarti saya kata tadi, environment yang to create the leadership that I had is started from the school study lah.
Wonderful, thank you Nasis. Before school pula, how about, dilahirkan di mana, dibesarkan di mana, your family, your parents?
Kalau ikut dari segi family background, saya ni a bit different sikit. Because my father ni dulu British Army. Dulu orang tua dulu zaman saya, dia tak kata askar, dia kata soja. And my father ni British Army ni, dia sergeant. And you just imagine lah, sergeant ni dia punya squish, dia punya garam. Betul, dia garam. Tapi alhamdulillah pula dia punya kegarangan tu tak turun kepada saya. Nampak tak? Betul.
Kena tanya staff LHDN ni.
Tapi saya cakap dengan my staff, you don't worry. Saya Zip, saya lembut tapi kalau usik-usik dia keras tau. So background sebagai family yang father tu tadi Amin pun mengajar saya juga. Pertamanya in term of discipline, oh you tahulah Amin kan, right? Rambut tak boleh panjang. Masa tu kalau dia tengah bercakap lalu pun dia tengok je mata tak, you know what kan? Sekarang kalau misalnya anak lalu you tengok mata dia tanya, hai. Kan? Zaman dulu mana berani? So itu semua mengajar kita menjadi lebih dewasa lah. So apa kalau you dengar lagu apa tadi?
No.
Okay. Lagu Melayu, doa buat kekasih kan? Apa dalam lirik dia kata?
Nanti sikit.
Itu salah. Ramli Sarif dan apa tadi Kak Cinta Ibrahim, dia kata apa? Sejarah mengajar kita dewasa. Nampak tak? Sejarah mengajar kita dewasa. So pada saya sejarah is very very apa important.
Okay. Thank you. So school, family, fashion sense.
Okay.
Itu nama. Thank you for coming in our color code today.
Okay.
For everyone's knowledge, kita hari ini on Fridays at YSN University Malaysia, we practice what we call formal Fridays. So everyone is dressed up to the nines. Typically, that's it. We're very relaxed here. We can wear jeans or khakis to work Mondays to Wednesdays. Tapi on Fridays we try and dress up, and today was red because of Chinese New Year. So itulah kita punya ni. So Tan Sri sendiri menganggap tentang penampilan diri dan sebagainya.
Okay, saya kebetulan pada masa pagi tadi I been told before by Cik Azib, dia kata Tan Sri on Friday you must be very casual lah. So saya kata fikir, dia kata tak mau pakai tie. So saya kata macam mana ni, aku baju pun nak pakai ni. Tak, ni orang rumah tak tahu Tan Sri ni, cik. So saya pun pilih-pilih saja, saya kata okay, since saya dah plan nak pakai baju ni, so saya kena cari yang kali kontras. So itu yang saya pilih merah. Without realizing, bila sampai dekat sini, saya disambut oleh merah. So pada saya sebenarnya color is very very apa meaningful. In Lembaga Sdn Negeri Malaysia, we have our signature color actually. We are using apa signature color, our signature color is a purple. Why purple, nanti I'll explain to you. You know why purple? Kita explain. Dan juga saya pun agree with apa Azib. You kena buat sesuatu yang orang lain tak buat, kita kena buat. You kena berani gitu. Kalau orang Kedah kata, kena ada telok lah. Kena ada telok. Tahu? Ya betul? Sebab apa? You just imagine that we know that typically kalau hari Jumaat, selalunya government agency pakai baju apa? Baju kebangsaan. Tapi you all choose to, you know. And the same thing we apply in Lembaga Sdn Negeri Malaysia, we effective 2014. Yang mana kita apply, apa tadi kita ada, apa tadi etika berpakaian, we started daripada last year. Iaitu every Tuesday kita dress down. Dress down. You just imagine lah, makcik-makcik nak pakai dress down ni. Kalau saya tanya makcik-makcik, sure dia tolak ni. But to me, I must be apa tadi, very practical. In my organisation, I have 11,000. You know, 11,000 apa member. We call it ourselves Hasilan. We shortly, oh, we are Hasilan. So we have 11,000 Hasilan. So that you must remember that in any organisation, on apa tadi, on the average, 70% of your members age 45 and below. Am I right?
Yeah.
45 and below. 70%. So, bila saya buat sesuatu decision, I give focus more on the 45 and below punya needs tadi. Kalau ikut saya 58 tahun, pakai So pada saya sebenarnya Azib pakaian adalah penting kerana untuk menggambarkan okay, being a CEO, the top of the hierarchy, people when look at me, I must be energetic. Am I right?
Yes.
I must be energetic, physically, mentally must be strong. No, what's that? Because you know, every day I'm facing with two. How do I manage my crisis? How do I manage perception? Every day. No, what's that? So, pada saya sebenarnya, this is very important. Dan of course, saya tak adalah apa tadi manager yang apa look into my pakaian lah. Tapi my advisor, anak saya di rumah lah. Sebab anak saya ni tadi, sebaya you. You berapa tahun umur?
28.
Jangan malu-malu. Enak kan? Uncle. So, saya ada 6 orang anak dan the eldest apa tadi sudah 32 tahun elders. Saya ada 5 orang cucu. Nampak tak? Jadi berarti so anak saya jadi sekarang ni advisor pada saya. Dia kata apa-apa dia kata oh pakai kena pakai slim fit. Kan? Tapi kalau ikut cara saya otai nak pakai ke slim fit. Tak boleh. Jadi saya pakai slim fit ini pun dah nampak wow.
Okay, thank you. That's the end of our one-on-one session. Okay. Ladies and gentlemen, Tan Sri Shukru.
Alright, thank you. Thank you. Sekali lagi kepada Yayasan University of Malaysia and apa tadi in particular, our friend. Okay, this is my apa tadi partner every month. Bukan partner in crime. Okay, this is Nazia.
Okay. Hai Mazia.
Hello. Fine. Tapi dia bukanlah orang cacat, tidak. Tapi dia tiap kali saya jumpa dia dalam one of my visit to dalam masa saya buat housewarming to her department, suddenly tengok I was told dia ada bakat ni. Saya kata okay, from there onwards saya kata you become my partner everywhere I go. Okay, bukan kerana you all pekat kat ni, tidak. Tetapi sometimes as a human being, kalau selalu puas marah-marah, kita kata puas cakap aku pekat ke telinga. Jadi sekurang-kurangnya kalau you rasa pekat ke telinga, Mazia cakap you boleh nampak lah. So there's no escape for you. Okay, so of course I'm here to share my experience in Lembaga Seram Negeri Malaysia. So as being mentioned by apa Azif tadi, saya dilantik pada tarikh 8 Januari 2011. Baru lagi lah, tapi saya adalah orang dalam. I'm a taxman. It's a typical taxman. But now you don't see that I'm a taxman. Okay? So apabila saya dilantik, saya lihat dalam keadaan Lembaga Seram Negeri Malaysia tadi, we have to do something. So apa kita tahu bahawa revenue is very very critical. Betul tak? Revenue ni kalau government revenue, kalau you all personal, tadi you punya income lah. Kalau you tak ada income, apa you jadi? Apa you jadi? Muflis, jadi beggar and everything, so susah. So sebab itulah kita di Lembaga Seram Negeri Malaysia, when I was appointed as a CEO, the first thing saya kata, because pada masa tu saya sudah berada di Jabatan Seram Negeri Malaysia in 1979, 12 Januari 79. You masih belum lahir lagi, my dear. Nampak tak? 79 lah. So saya dah masuk Lembaga Seram, Jabatan Hasil dan masa tu. So bila saya dilantik sebagai CEO, it's not new to me. So saya dah grow dalam dance culture. But to me, I think there must be something yang tak begitu hebat kerana kita underutilize our own capacity. So I believe that the fact that government change from jabatan to lembaga in 1996, government expect something. So finally, bila saya dilantik, and suddenly the first apa tadi perhimpunan bersama dengan ketua pengarah dan masa tu saya lah diumumkan apa tadi kemasukan Datuk Dr. Muhammad Syukur pop yang saya keluar lagu We Will Rock You. How do you feel? Macam mana you rasa? Depan dan belakang tak betul kan? Ini betul kan ini? Because tak pernah ketua pengarah. Nama ketua pengarah punya garang. Kalau tak garang bukan ketua pengarah, kononnya lah dululah. Nampak tak? So to me, I can tell you here, we are dealing with human. Am I right? We are talking, nanti kita cerita tentang inovasi. So saya kata, I have to do something to introduce you my theme song, We Will Rock You. I explain kepada mereka what it, why I chose that song. Okay, We Will Rock You is a motivational song. Sebenarnya saya dapat song tu sebab saya peminat wrestling. Betul, saya peminat wrestling. The Rock. The Rock kan? Rock, kata kan? Ya? Sekarang John Cena begitu. Okay, so saya minta pada Lembaga Sedar Indonesia, okay, look here. Pada masa tu kita perlu do something because saya rasakan bahawa Lembaga Sedar Indonesia kena speed up. Nampak, we have to speed up because selama ni kita mungkin kita tidak gunakan kita punya strength. We have the opportunity tapi kita tak gunakan kita punya strength. Okay, so saya rasakan okay. Saya beritahu kepada my officer, the first thing saya beritahu in 2011, the first kali saya set in the first year my internal target, my dream. My dream in 2011, saya kata, we want to collect not less than 100 billion. Semua orang pandang saya tu, memanglah dia pandang saya, tak pasal dia akan pandang saya. Dia pandang-pandang, saya tahu dalam keadaan percaya tak percaya. Pasal apa, we never across that 100 billion. The highest we managed to get in 2008, 90 billion. Then the following year, in 2009, it was dropped to 88 billion. But then further drop, it is, so you get nampak slide tu. So suddenly, saya dilantik sebagai CEO, man, dalam keadaan macam ini. Saya kata, okay, this is the real test on my leadership. Whether boleh tak saya turn around lembaga, saya teringat, saya bayangkan saya ni macam orang Jepun tau. Jepun kan? Hai.
Bukan.
Konnichiwa? Konnichiwa. Ada modis kah? Yes, patutnya arigato budaimasu. Lupa di surat tanya tu, jadi saya kata, oh ada modis kah? Sudah kena. Okay. So saya berpendapat macam kalau, you just to recall apa Japan punya history. In 1945 during Second World War II, yang mana Jepun kena bom dua tempat tu, Hiroshima and Nagasaki. Am I right? You all belajar history. Then suddenly apa tadi Amerika rasa macam apa tadi apa bersalah, try to rebuild Japan. Apa yang dihantar dua pakar kualiti, Deming and Juren. And Deming and Juren started the quality culture for Japanese. So di situ saya pegang konsep tu, 2 tahun ni dianggap macam 2 tahun kena bom atom lah. So saya kata, saya kena bangkit. So saya kata, beritahu pada my officer, we start to have our dream internally. So in 2011, in fact, the figure given to us to collect 91B initially lah, but of course lepas tu dia revise. So kalau you tengok dekat figure tu, kita manage to close 109. It's a big jump from 86 billion in 2010, suddenly in 2011, 109 billion. Banyak atau billion? Okay, in 2012, we have our internal target lagi. So we managed to close 125 billion. And in 2013 last year 128.9. Okay. Okay. So result, saya tak boleh medal the result because you know why? Whatever figure collected by Lembaga Sedar Negeri been confirmed by accountant negara. So saya tak boleh make up the figure. Okay, so pada pendapat saya, why it happened that way? So I believe that is leadership. Leadership. So because leadership, leader on the top of the hierarchy must act as a leader and must have a leadership quality, bagaimana teamwork, innovation, motivation and so forth. That's why Yayasan Inovasi Malaysia, it is here. You've been formed in 2008. Kita bagi tepukan kepada dia. Don't forget untuk jumpa saya lagi lah. Promo. You know why? Because without innovation, I don't think that we can excel. So that's why government realize that they must have some organization to kata tu apa tadi pastikan benda ni tadi. Okay, we go to the next slide. Dan saya berpendapat as a leader, there are two things I must do hand in hand. First, on the top there, saya dah kata tadi leadership. And when we talk organization, we are dealing with people, am I right? People. Kalau you tengok dekat apa overseas, animal show tu, Mak Saleh boleh cakap dengan kucing dia. Nama tak? Jepun lagi bagus. Doraemon, apa kucing dia pandai cakap? Doraemon. Kita macam mana orang Melayu dah lama dah beli kucing. Sorry, kita ambil Melayu. Macam mana orang Melayu dah apa beli kucing? Apa kucing nak pandai cakap? You all makan isi. Bila dah tinggal tulang bagi kucing. Mana kucing nak pandai? You tengok, you cuba bagi whiskers. Nampak tak? I mean, ini semua kita tanpa kita sedari itu. So, pada saya, ladies and gentlemen, to conclude lah, ini bukan nak cerita akademik, but just to recap. So first kali saya lakukan adalah saya anggap myself as a prime mover. I want to move my resources, my people. Okay, I have 3M, man, machine and money. To how do I move that? So that I mesti gerakkan dia and I act as a prime mover. Nampak tak? Macam nak gerakkan orang. Let's say lah, if I were to test you all today lah. Ladies and gentlemen, I would like to announce, please stand up. Please stand up. Nobody to stand up. It's only at the back there. Why? Because ladies and gentlemen. Yeah. Cuma kita, okay, sekarang bangun. Oh, come on. Kenapa tak? Maksudnya tadi bukanlah you all bekak. Maksudnya tadi. But, to gerakkan orang sebenarnya, kena ada something yang concrete. So, this is what it mean by prime mover. Prime mover. Jadi, that's why in the context of Lembaga Sedum lagi, we set the direction. Where are we heading to? Why and how? Itu kalau siapa nak buat theory, nak belajar management, there is organizational behavior. Okay, I'm not going to elaborate. On the other side, to complement that great motivator, apa itu saya kena bertindak sebagai great motivator. I have to motivate my people. Yes, you are good boy. Yes, you are good girl. Oh, do that. Yes. Okay, masalah kita sekarang dekat orang Melayu. Saya ambil contact orang Melayu lah. Kita jamu dia macam nak rak, dia pun datang rumah makan itu ini. So, how's the food? Okay lah. Cuba tengok, bukan nak kata apa lah. To some extent, we have to learn from the Western. Oh, so great your food. Wow, wonderful. Nama tak? Tapi kita okay lah. Not bad. Kita malu. Nama tak? Kalau malu terlalu banyak, besar kemaluan. Yelah. Dia paling kecil besar macam. Okay. So, okay. Jadi pada saya, kalau you nak belajar management theory, that's great motivator tu, itu adalah dari segi human factor HR. Dan bila you combine the two, bila ahli dalam you punya organisasi realize where are we heading to, they know that dia punya welfare dijaga, dia tahu dia disayangi. So finally, acceptance akan tinggi, awareness akan tinggi, am I right? Then finally, productivity akan naik. Okay, percaya tak? Okay, kita go to the next. Ini yang dikatakan balancing act. Di antara kita selama ni, kalau support organisasi, sorry lah, especially bila kita support organisasi, kita kata, oh, corporate governance. In fact, kita ada internal auditor pun dekat situ. Tetapi kita lupa bahawa corporate governance itself, without the people who man that apa tadi SOP, it doesn't work. So how you balance the two? Alright. So pada pendapat saya, in any organisation macam sekarang yayasan. Okay. Yang menghidupkan yayasan sebenarnya bukan bangunan ni. Yang menghidupkannya is your member. You. You are the one there because you are the soul of the. Nampak tak? Super juga. Macam I was told that ada apa nurses daripada Hospital Lampang. Apa lagi kata orang? Saya kawasan Lampang. Tak ada orang? Hospital Lampang. Tak sampai lagi. Ataupun malu-malu nak angkat. Okay, contohnya hospital. You can have a very canggih bangunan. Tapi kalau yang jadi nurse, yang jadi doktor, yang bekerja dekat dalam tu garang. Apa nak? Yang waktu pesakit makin sakit. Not because of the bangunan, but because of the person. So itulah yang saya kata tadi, saya kata the soul. Okay, so human governance is very very critical because human behavior. We are dealing with human behavior, and behavior they started with attitude. You must have the right attitude, okay? Then dia akan bentuk human behavior, and as a whole, the behavior become the culture of the organization. Betul tak? Di situlah kita lihat. Okay. Apa yang saya lakukan for the past 3 years di Lembaga Senologi Malaysia, none other than all the Hasilian, I want them to feel good at work. When they come to the work, they feel good. They want to come to the office. They love to come to the office. You know, that's the most important, feel good at work. Okay. So, dan you tahu bahawa Lembaga Senologi Malaysia ni, in our context, we have 11,000 officers, members, dan kita spread nationwide 36 branches. Okay, so spread jauh. So kita bawa dia, kita kata okay, look here, even though we are apa diversified in term of apa tadi tempat and everything, diversity, tapi we must be unity. So saya launkan perkataan unity in diversity. Okay, dan di sinilah saya perkenalkan new terminology. Kingdom of Hasil. Ini shock sendiri je. Saya pun tak jadi gaji syukur kan. Sebab saya orang Melaka tak ada sultan. Kalau tidak saya pun kan jadi bakal sultan. Tapi yang bakal sultan tu bukan saudara saya. Itu bukan saudara saya tu. Tetapi saya berazam, saya anggap, oh saya kata being the top of the hierarchy. So we tell them that, okay, everybody here, we are in the kingdom of Hasil. This is our own nation. Nama tak? This is our own world. So kita ada kita punya activity, everything semua tertakluk. Dan saya kata the topmost apa tadi tempat adalah apa tadi my pejabat CEO office. Pejabat CEO. Dan jadi berarti saya beritahu kepada my officer. Okay, cuba you tengok our national anthem. Bagaimana sini kata national anthem dia kata. Negaraku kan tanah tumpah daratku. Saya tak nyanyi kau tak kalau saya nyanyi betul kau kena nyanyi kena berdiri. So, saya faham. So apa dia? Yang last chorus kita apa? Rahmat bahagia Tuhan kurniakan. Nampak tak? Raja kita selamat bertahta. Okay. Maksudnya tadi dalam national anthem, what we want, negara tu rakyat bersatu. Dan kita nak raja kita dalam keadaan peaceful. Raja sentiasa bertahta. So dalam konteks Lembaga Sedia Negara Malaysia, saya beritahu pada my officer, you must make sure that the king of hasil must be always berada dalam keadaan kesejahteraan. You just imagine kalau saya bengong, datang ofis bengong. The whole 11,000 will bengong, you know. It's a strike of pen saya, betul tak kan? So that's the duty. So make your boss tenteram. Tapi your boss also must be reciprocal dengan you all lah, kan? Okay. So di sini saya berpendapat, saya menggunakan 7 L's, the right culture. Now we are talking about the right culture. Okay, I'm not going to elaborate more, tapi kita quickly. We go the first one. Okay, macam mana saya transform Lembaga Sedia Negara Malaysia. Okay, kalau Lembaga Sedia Negara Malaysia, in 2020, we want to be world class. World class. Alright. So kita go very quickly. Yang ini you know. Okay, saya buat this roadmap to my officer. Saya kata look here, this is our roadmap. Saya menggunakan F1 circuit. So diorang tanya, kenapa tak gunakan plus punya circuit? Oh, plus punya tak ada gangguan. Pasal apa dia highway. Di sini you dapat jalan yang berliku-liku. Nampak tak kan? Bukan kita pilih jalan yang berliku, tapi jenis kita tadi adalah berliku. So saya gunakan Formula 1 punya apa gambar dekat situ. Because Formula 1 It's a very fast vehicle. Dan kita ada pit stop. Pit stop di sini yearly pit stop. Itu yang kita apply yearly pit stop. This is our roadmap. Dan saya apply dia punya team of the year. Next slide. So in 2011 saya perkenalkan Melaka Transformasi. 2012 menerokai Lautan Biru. 2013 menerajui dan mengurus perubahan, leading and managing change. And this year I just launched the team managing tax ecosystem for sustainable growth. Okay. So KPI, orang tanya ala lembaga sedar negeri dia dapat bonus tinggi pasal KPI. So kenapa pula nak marah? So what? Yes, our KPI we been given KPI. Dan we have 10 components of KPI dan kita ada ecosystem dia. Di sini yang kita gunakan color Cik Zee, ungu, purple tu is the highest color because mengikut dari segi apa tadi color scheme, in fact the highest aura is the purple. Merah ni danger. Dia can stand for bila merah stop, no entry. No entry eh? Tak betul. So kita ambil purpose. Okay, because we are here apa tu. Kemudian lepas tu saya explain pada my officer bagaimana kita explain tentang KPI. Saya tak nak explain pada you sini lah. Yang mana dia punya output, yang mana dia punya apa tadi outcome. Di sini saya nak share sikit. Most of bosses ni tadi dia bertindak nak tengok efficiency. Efficiency is in term of processes. When you are on the top of the hierarchy, it is not your duty to see the efficiency. You must get things right. So you talk about effectiveness. There are two different level antara effectiveness and efficiency. Okay, alright. We move. So saya perkenalkan tagline, be with us. Tadi you dengar lagu We Will Rock You kan? So kita ada tambah dekat situ, be with us, otherwise we will rock you. We will rock you to be with us. So saya perkenalkan, nothing is impossible. Nampak tak? Nothing is impossible. Kemudian, last year kita to taxpayer, kita kata hasil, you feel good partner. You must feel good to us. Alright, nanti saya tunjukkan. Okay, so let's take a break lah sekejap. Okay, Syam. Do you think that this one can happen during office hour? And I was there. I was there, you know, it's not like this type of forum. I was there. But why I do that? The reason is very simple. Because I trust my officer. You do it, whatever that you think. You nak tunjuk dengan saya apa yang you boleh tunjukkan. Okay, kita go to the next slide. Because saya berpendapat, when I started, I never mentioned about paradigm shift. Tetapi saya gunakan istilah rebranding. Why I gunakan istilah rebranding instead of apa paradigm shift? Because kita tahu dalam teori, management teori kata paradigm shift. Nanti orang marah, kenapa pula you nak suruh dia tukar? Kan? Just because you baru naik jawatan, you suruh orang tukar lah kan? So saya buat very simple. Saya kata, okay, saya announce I'm going to introduce a rebranding within the first 100 days of my appointment. Within 100 days. So, saya perkenalkan ikrar baru, new oath. Apa tadi saya perkenalkan, apa saya jadikan 1 Mac 1999 sebagai hari hasil and we celebrate our anniversary. Before that, we never celebrate. Even though sudah 14 years masa tu. Never celebrate. Nampak tak? Lepas tu saya perkenalkan lagu corporate baru. Lagu corporate masa kita nyanyi sebelum tu, dia diperkenalkan in 1991. So saya rasa lagu tu tak relevan untuk menjadikan semangat because we are in lembaga now. Lagu korporat lama tu apa dia nada dia sesuai pada masa tersebut lah. Bukan saya kata salah. That time yes. Nak dengar sikit di antara lagu dengan antara nada dia. Dulu kalau nak nyanyi lagu tu kena berdiri. Betul. So saya pun puas dah berdiri lagu tu. Kena pegang lagu ni.
Di antara
dia lirik dia kata berganding tangan kita bersama. So you bayangkan lagu tu sesuai then, tapi adakah lagu tu sesuai forever? Sedangkan dalam keadaan Gen Y sekarang ni tadi hip hop, betul tak kan? Hip hop. Okay, so macam-macam saya perkenalkan. Okay, among di antaranya, dan apabila apa kita perkenalkan lagu tersebut, tiba-tiba saya beri kelonggaran kepada my officer. Saya kata, okay, ada cawangan kata, Tan Sri boleh tak kalau kami apa tukar lirik lagu ni kepada lagu apa mengikut budaya tempatan? Di Temuloh keluarkan lagu Semai, orang Semai pun pandai nyanyi dalam bahasa Semai lah. Orang Sarawak tukar lagu apa dalam Sarawak. Kemudian yang Sabah tukar, saya kata okay, after all it's a corporate song, what? Something for you to learn. And then suddenly one of the macam semalam punya program, jabatan apa prosesan apa jabatan pematuhan cukai, dia kata we want to introduce apa tadi lagu Inggeris, lagu dalam Inggeris. Apa Inggeris, saya kata okay, why don't you try? Okay, kita lihat, saksikan. Kita saksikan. Dia panggil hasil style. Tapi of course lah, hero mesti ada dalam lah. Ni last year punya ni. Oh, So you all tengok. Bukan saya suruh orang buat, but they voluntarily, voluntarily no, they show it to us. This is during the PKM yang sebenarnya you tengok tu. Pada masa dia orang jadi host in 2012. And I was told that they do the collection their own. They buat rakaman dekat luar. Why? When the soldier, when you win the heart of your soldier willing to die for you. Am I right? That's the most important. Okay. Kita tengok, kita dok cerita inovasi kreativiti dalam lembaga seni Malaysia. Apa yang saya buat ni very very simple, but you can see a bigger impact. Simple aja. Saya gunakan platform perhimpunan bulanan. Kita perhimpunan bulanan ni masa sekolah ada, dekat sekolah pun dulu ada perhimpunan, ada kat mingguan, ada kat bila waktu dekat office pun ada. Lepas tu puas pula marah-marah. Dah lah jumpa 11 kali marah. Betul. So saya rasa tak efektif. So I feel that I must take opportunity. This the golden apa tadi opportunity for me this apa meeting my members once a month. So saya kata okay. In 2011 saya pula kenalkan perhimpunan bulanan yang jadi host mengikut giliran jabatan. Wah, selama ni corporate com yang pegang, selama tu tiap bulan dia ada ikut giliran. So saya kata you form your own apa choir, you form your own leader. Nampak tak? Lepas tu dia dah mula compete among them. Okay. So apa saya berpendapat, in 2012-2013 kita tukar nama dia kepada program Creativity Minda. Because we give empowerment, they take opportunity, they create teamwork, sense of belonging, esprit de corps. Nampak tak kan? So dia buat problem solving, finally dia punya project. Yang depan slide ni kalau you nak belajar, inilah KIK. Okay, quality circle, this is the theory of quality circle. Alright, kita tengok. Ini gambar dia antara gambar dekat lembaga seni dulu lah, before. Berdiri tengah panas, memang tak ada yang senyum. Betul. Pukul 8 pagi. Pukul 8. Bos, Big Nanda kalau malam semalam tu hujan, pagi tu orang-orang kita jalan lecap. Bos jangan relax, pasal apa dia dah ada kapet. Nampak tak? Tapi you tengok after. You see the difference? Nampak tak? You see the difference. Itu baru still picture. It's okay. Ada lagi nanti. Okay. Why? Kerana apa yang kita nak sekarang tadi? Untuk melihat dari segi saya tukar dia kepada creativity. We are now assemble once a month in Cyberjaya di Ibu Pejabat. Dan saya dah cawang-cawang pun kena buat yang sama. Perjumpaan setiap bulan tadi bukan lagi untuk berhibur, tapi kita nak tengok creativity. So now we rename dia sebagai Creative Showcase. Nampak tak? Kita tengok sikit sekejap. Ini compilation lah. Dia jabatan yang besar, dia buat sendiri. Kalau yang kecil, dia akan gombal. Ini yang tengok ni dekat dewan semalam Itulah tempat dia macam ni dia tukar dewan tu.
trio rendah yang berlaku.
Yang kita boleh sebenarnya semangat. So sebab itulah saya jadikan itu sebagai satu platform untuk mereka jadi tukar makna. You can see that, you know, every month different host, different apa tadi team yang orang bawa. Nampak tak kan? I think Hazib sendiri dah lihat, you sendiri dah lihat, nampak tak how we kick off in 2014, 2 years ago. So bukan tipu. And then because why they feel good at work, when they feel good, they throw anything. Dan syarat saya sebagai CEO, I must be very sporting. Betul tak kan? So dan kita dah perkenalkan flexi hours. Di lembaga saya Malaysia, kita dah, I think we are the first lah. Perkenalkan flexi hours in our organisasi. And suddenly saya dapat very good apa tadi moral booster from my officer. Oh, dia kata terima kasih lah Tan Sri. You just imagine before this, before flexi hours, kalau orang jauh, lewat 15 minit, Allah nak menghadap bos, mana tak? Bos pula tak pernah senyum. Kenapa lambat? Orang dah lambat, dia tanya kenapa lambat? Sepatutnya bos, bila orang datang lambat, boleh saya bantu? Betul tak kan? Do you have that long? No, never. Bos kata, kenapa lambat? Kenapa tak? Tapi dia suruh frontliner, bila frontliner, bila public kata, dia kata, you kena gunakan perkataan, boleh saya bantu. Tapi dia sendiri tak nak. So you don't walk your talk, man. And saya rebrand kita punya public relation officer, PRO. We don't call PRO, we call CCO. Stand for customer care officer. Because we not caring is loving. You know, caring is loving. Nampak tak? And then even our auditor, kita kata, we don't call them auditor, or itu kita kata, you are, we as auditor, kita pakai PES, hasil is your compliance partner. Compliance, kita tak seorang comply. Itu memang ada thing. So dress apa etika tadi saya dah terangkan on the second day of the week every Tuesday. If you come to our office, they really very casual, smart casual, yeah, very smart casual. Okay, why 11? Because I believe that as a leader, saya must treat myself, must act as a celebrity. Am I right?
Yeah.
Celebrity ini bukan kerana nak jadi pelakon. Tidak. Celebrity means that bila jadi celebrity, you become idola to your followers. Betul tak kan? Dia pandang you, ya. Saya ingat. Eh, doktor, eh? I think apa during my time lah, not your time. Okay, yeah. My time in 70s, my time when I was 70s masa tu John Travolta punya zaman tau, Saturday Night Fever.
Nak.
Masa tu Zim eh, kalau jalan kita pakai bell bottom. Betul, you tengok film, bell bottom. Masa kita nak ikut trend, apa, we are must be trendy masa tu. Kalau jalan 10 orang Zim eh, Dewan Mandarin happy because nampak tak? And you tengok Elvis Presley, rambut dia orang tu ikut, nampak tak kan? So as a boss, as a CEO, as a chief of organization, you must be orang tengok jadi idola, jadi ikutan, celebrity, nampak tak kan? Tapi macam mana you nak jadi celebrity kalau nampak orang pun tak nak senyum? Nampak? You semua orang senyum to your client, you yourself tak nak senyum to your, nampak tak? So pada saya, this is the problem, Zip. Kita cerita inovasi ni, sebenarnya inovasi perasaan ni kita kena buat dulu awal. Supaya bila pandang orang senyum, nampak tak? Berbaik sangka. Ini bila tengok orang, oh ini dah buruk sangka ni. Ini nampak tak kan? Nampak tak? Okay, jangan. So ini yang mustahak. Okay, so dan saya dalam kita punya function macam itu, I think Aziz aware that kita buat live streaming so that every big function nationwide akan tengok melalui TV je tau. We have our live streaming. Kemudian ada putusan-putusan daripada CEO. In fact, apa tadi kita, saya dalam sistem every day akan churn apa tadi e-birthday apa wish. You tengok birthday wish dia eh. Okay, kita go tu. Gambar saya tu. Saya memang pilih gambar-gambar ya.
Yes,
betul lah. Nampak tak kan? And then suddenly bila saya dapat respon daripada orang, dia kata 30 years in service, never receive this type of, nampak tak? Padahal bukan kena bayar pun. Betul tak kan? Tapi pasal apa? Pasal you katakan, bila orang buat, dia kata lah, itu pun, itu aku buat, tapi kau tak buat. Nampak tak kan? Do it. Okay? Alright. Dan kita tengok, suddenly, Lembaga Sdm Malaysia, last year especially, kita dapat so many awards, tiga award daripada Malaysia Book of Record. Dalam kita program CSR kita di Merin, apa tadi Pulau Perhentian. And then you masuk itu dalam apa, Litua di Hasil, Red Race, Litua di Hasil. And then awal tahun yang itu kita dapat another CSR di Potek Kinabalu, Manukat. And of course, not to forget the who behind the scene lah. See? Tak, Zim eh? Who behind the scene lah, tak eh? So tu kena kenal lah tu siapa dia tu. None other than. Okay? So okay, Syam, yang ni kita boleh skip jam. Okay. Another thing saya nak share dengan you, journey beyond the future. Ini ditunjukkan kepada saya oleh Cawangan Kuching when I visited them on 5 Jun. You tengok how they recap 2 years punya experience.
We will rock you.
So ini super last year Allah. So you tengok dari Kuching in 2013 when I visited them, bagaimana pengharapan mereka, nampak tak? If not now, you know, if not apa you who else, if not now when, so they have to pay for itu. Dan satu lagi sebenarnya yang saya, I'm very crazy. I like to try new things. So happen that. Jadi saya baru dapat a new secretary lah. Adila, can you stand up? So dia pun tak tahu ni. Dia pun tak tahu. Tapi we already tested her. So just a short while, you dengar eh. Apa speciality dia? Alright. Then when we had a meeting in.
Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. 我亲爱的大家们, 经过2013年12月，我们2014年新的挑战。 在我们喜欢庆祝2013年的氛围，我衷心大家珍藏的感谢神，因为他们被获准继续在这比赛运动地球，在我们最爱的马来西亚，国家很多被获的富饶，也很多快乐的财富，这个国家的全体人民生活的和睦相处。 和平如果比其他的国家他们活在空前最不稳定混乱时由于政治动荡无尽和社会发展。
It is my duty searching for the star. Bintang mencari bintang. Bintang kejora mencari bintang, betul? It is my duty, betul tak kan? Tapi kalau kita, dia sebenarnya very, very simple sih. Inovasi tadi, you tak suruh orang buat. Jadi dua kali je you kena buat. Pertama, beri mereka peluang, opportunity. Kedua, beri mereka ruang, environment. Peluang without environment, tak boleh macam sekarang. Contoh, I sokong you ni, apa you boleh participate ni? You boleh main game ni, tapi ingat main malam-malam. You boleh pergi begini, tapi ingat lepas ofis. Tak boleh lah. You give them peluang, together with ruang. Peluang without ruang, there's no way. So, bintang mencari bintang. So, saya akhiri my slot ni dengan another one. Don't surprise Yang ini, it was produced in 2012 by bahagian apa risiko. Yeah man, we can have apa tadi. Don't call it Q&A man. Very common. Kita kata apa tadi, participation from the audience. Oh, man. Okay, you see this one.
amazing story of achievement over the years.
Success is the attribute to his education. After graduating from one of the most distinguished universities, first working with the UN on solutions for global sustainability.
It's a solution.
Because saya tengok macam benda tu, macam dia superimpose kan. Macam tu, bukan senang. Of course, orang kata anak itu dalam YouTube, orang kata you buat lah kalau boleh. Nampak tak kan? Betul tak Syam kan? Syam, ada satu poin-poin Syam. Kita tengok sekejap boleh. Kita tengok. Ini daripada ini, cawangan fikir. Because pada saya, apabila... Okay, ini tentang bagaimana education yang orang buat. Tengok Kita
Lepas tu, kau terus je, terus Terus je.
Oh, tak singil punya tu apa-apa kau diam.
Eh, haa, baru tu ingat. Dah cukup dah duit aku nak minas sini Alofa ni.
Itu aku dia ya. Rawatan awal ni nanti senanglah sikit.
Ingat tau plan kita tadi?
Jangan takut tu Abah. Saya janji ceritakan yang baik-baik aja pasal tu Abah.
Masih nak cakap. Masih ya. Nak, ambil lah suara ni.
Air je, gaji naik sekali lah tu Abah.
Oh my god. Dah sampai dah. Ada maklumat. Kasih tolong sama dia.
Susahnya nak dapat parking sini. Seorang lagi kawan tengah parking. Nanti dia sampai.
Waalaikumsalam. Tak main tak apa. Semua kepala aku.
Hai Boboiboy. Susah parking. Lambat kan? Baik kita mula sekarang. Kalau tak lambat mula lagi.
Iyalah. Petang ni Pak Ustaz jumpa aku pula. Aduh. Pakcik, saya macam punya rekod.
Mana ada rekod?
Sir, satu hari berapa?
Entah.
Berapa untung margin yang pakcik dapat?
Margin? Ni, pakcik jual yang koko lah. Bukan margin.
Ada minum sendiri tak?
Pakcik ni tak ada lah. Si manis. Tapi si gopal ni aku tak tahulah. Buruk lantak awak ni.
Masa
orang tua ni. Halo, cik. Dari kampet ni?
Ya. Kenapa?
Dengan cerita, nampak banyak bonus tau ni. Aku tak kerja kosong kat sana. Saya dah bosan kerja kat tadi ni.
Kami nak tanyalah, Tok Abah jual apa kat sini?
Ada jual macam-macam coklat dekat sini. Kek coklat, ais krim coklat, bola coklat, dan yang paling laris sekali, Tok Abah Special Hot Coklat. Untung bersih setiap hari aja RM500 dan kadang-kadang lebih.
Tak sama ni. Tadi, Tok Abah kata satu je.
Kadang-kadang Tok Abah ambil untung sampai 100%. Tu tak ambil kira yang dia ambil untuk makan dan minum sendiri. Banyak untung dia ni sebenarnya.
Oi, mangkuk tingkat dia sudah. Pandai-pandai yang ni.
Oh, lebih sudah Tok Abah ni kedekut orangnya. Cik lupakan apa yang saya cakap tadi.
Ya, yeah, cerita kita pergi tiga dah tu. Nanti kalau dia ni come to my office. So, this is another one. You see, tengokkan bagaimana creativity. Because I allow them, I give them freedom. They take the opportunity to show it to me. Kan? And then dah sekarang dah jadi macam satu apa budaya in our organisasi. Dan satu lagi yang saya menjadikan platform inovasi ni tadi, saya menggunakan budaya tu menanamkan inovasi. Budaya, macam you tengok menyanyi, menari. Because it's not so much about menari, it's not so much about apa menyanyi. Tetapi the message macam tadi you dengar lagu yang saya buka tadi hasil sekarang kan. Paling senang dia perasan dia tadi nama pasukan tu, dia nama kumpulan tu apa dia? Di Lesong Batu. Sebenarnya Lesong Batu kan. Tapi the way the creative way dia presented apa Lesong tu, dia spell eh Di Lesong Batu tu BAR2TWO. So dia talk about creativity. You know what I mean? Kemudian macam tadi you tengok puisi, everything. So over there, walaupun mereka nampak menyanyi, tetapi mereka change the lyric to become motivational song. Nampak tak? So itu yang mustahak yang saya kata tadi. Zip, sebenarnya pemikiran, attitude must be right, you know. You hantarlah orang tu pergi kursus macam mana pun, kan? Tapi kalau dia punya hati dan dia punya pikiran dekat sini dengan hati ni tak jive ya tadi, dia tak akan jadi. So, apa masalah kita yang banyak berlaku yang saya perhatikan, mungkin anda dikenaki buat 10 perkara tu, 10 perkara. Tapi out of 10 tu 2 perkara anda tak boleh lakukan, maka yang 2 perkara tu telah menghantui yang 8. Oh, aku tak boleh buat ni, tak boleh buat ni because of the 2. Padahal kalau you do it the rest, you can do that. Nampak tak?
Macam ada orang tanya saya, bila you buat ni macam mana? Saya bukan nak menanggung DAF ataupun apa Maharaja Lawak, apa tu kan? Kalau saya nak jaga undi, memang ada dia akan minta mengundi. Tapi the environment yang saya dapat, I think saya punya undian lebih daripada kalau keluar pun masuk balik. Betul tak kan? Because now people, now they talk on my behalf. You know, and the most important peer group, they can talk among them. That's the most important. Bila peer group bercakap tadi, that's the first hurdle yang kita dah dapat lah. So saya, itulah dia. Dan sekarang saya serah kepada apa tadi, back to you. Hi.
Hi.
Okay, for the audience participation.
Okay, thank you. As we said, audience participation time. But before that, I think even now he deserves a big round of applause. Presentation. Before we go into questions, I'd like to acknowledge that we have various friends from the media today. Kita ada daripada Utusan, daripada Malaysian SME, Harian Metro, Guangming Daily, Nanyang, Sinchu, Oriental Daily, TV Tiga, dan big round of applause for our media friends. Thank you for coming to this small event of ours. So, the floor is yours, ladies and gentlemen. Ada apa-apa soalan untuk Tan Sri? Dimulakan dengan Dr. Mazalan kami.
Thank you very much. I think what an awesome story. For the first time, saya rasa saya tak marah LSDN lah sebab bayar cukai. Tan Sri, I mean, there's a lot of successes that you are sharing with us, but I want to know the barriers, you know, the hurdles. You mentioned one. So what are the hurdles, internal as well as external? Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you. We start with internal dulu lah. Internal ni macam ni lah. No matter what you buat, there's always someone yang don't want to participate. Am I right? Kalau you buat bell curve tadi, they always outlier on the left and on the right. On the right tu okay, you don't worry because they become hardcore follower yang saya you nampak tadi. Yang silent killer tadi, because dia punya attitude tu memang dah kehel. Memang dah jam. Whoever boss, dia memang semua tak betul. So we try to appeal to them. Since they don't want to participate, it's okay, fine. Nampak tak? Yang penting tadi, kita nak jaga silent majority. Silent majority ni at any point of time can be influenced by either hardcore follower or silent villain. And this is very important. That's why kita punya macam apa yang saya buat, saya punya putusan, saya untuk masuk, clear to that. But so far, Alhamdulillah lah. You know, I don't get 100%, of course. We don't talk about 100%, we're talking about the majority. External, you are talking about barrier, yes. Barrier yang saya dapati macam ni lah. Pertamanya, of course, pembayar cukai, pinggir pembayar cukai. None of the pembayar cukai want us to be too efficient. Betul tak kan? Because apabila kita, especially bila kita OT, ada yang tak suka. Siapa suka kita datang? Datang. Because our visit is considered as uncalled for. So, itu hendak. Tapi apa yang kita buat, doktor, sebab itu saya perkenalkan tagline to the taxpayer that be with us. And 2012 kita kata you are nation hero. When you pay your tax, you are nation hero. And then tahun lepas kita kata okay, hasil is your feel good partner. You must be feel good dealing with us. You must trust us. And then of course we hope that apa tadi policy government tadi to understand. And then because of the trust to us, without realizing, we get the highest apa tadi award daripada government of Malaysia. Tapi not in the form of award, not in the form of certificate. What? Apa dia? Actually, apabila kita diberikan tanggungjawab menguruskan BRIM, Bantuan Rakyat Satu Malaysia. That was very very amazing to me. Because of the trust given to us, government trust us, kan? Kita. Because it's not part of our duty. It's not part of our petani core business before this. Dan kita lihat bagaimana pentingnya tadi itu. So pada saya, barrier is still there. We are not talking about apa zero defect. Okay, tetapi pada saya, as we go along, and after as we go along, we try to apa tadi to minimize the error. Okay, yang penting tadi kita kena kata tadi yakin. Okay, kena yakin, because without keyakinan, I don't think kita boleh. Nampak tak? So itulah saya rasa that's the apa the possible.
Thank you, Tan Sri. Can we have the next question from the floor, please? Silakan. Yeah.
I would like to find out if income tax can try to very very simplify the tax filing process, because I came through a very expensive tax filing mistake.
Okay, thank you. Alright, that's apa tadi great idea. I'm a good actor, ma. Yes, totally agree with you as a citizen of Malaysia. But you must realize that tax apa tadi tax system is reflection of the tax law. Okay, is reflection of the tax law. I personally, as a DG of IRB, what I want is your payment. I don't care how you declare. You just give me the check. You know that? Just give me the check. I don't care from which source. You want to pay 10,000? Okay, you buy. Tetapi the written form tu tadi being used by policy makers sebagai data entry. Okay? Written form tu being used by policy maker dekat apa MOF being tadi data entry. So bila data entry and then dia nak simpan too many data. So sebab itu yang bila too many data dia nak simpan, jadi akhirnya become the form jadi complicated. You know tak? It become complicated. Okay. So kita dealing with you once a year. Nampak tak? Once a year pun you rasa macam nak lah. Apalagi kalau kita jumpa you every day. Nampak tak kan? Ha. So memang saya tak nampikan. So there is a way, yes. Now through the system, by right, we should have a central database. But the problem is none of the government agency yang nak jadi anchor untuk to be the custody of central database. Kalau ada, senang. Kita just pakai our IC, is just kita punya key. We can access everything. Now everywhere you go, you have to declare the same thing. Your name, IC number, nama tak, alamat and everything. Barat, kita punya itu. Because of this is the problem yang kita rasakan, bahawa kalaulah government bersetuju untuk ada central database, then there shouldn't be any problem. I wish. You tak payah hantar orang, kita tengok je gambar ni. Oh, you payah sepuluh. Tadi kan dia pakai kunci. Nampak tak? Better lah. Not now, maybe in the 100 years akan datang. Thank you for the comment.
Thank you, Dasri. Thank you very much. I have a question via, bukan SMS lagi, sekarang WhatsApp lah.
Okay.
Daripada WhatsApp from Dr. Khairman Al-Johri, is one of our experts. Kita ada kumpulan pakar inovasi yang bersama-sama kita ke seluruh negara untuk mencari inovasi. So his idea is, I'd like to propose, or before that he said, there's only two things constant in life, death and taxes. So he said, I'd like to propose a special innovators tax incentive for innovators and also people working for the development of innovation. Orang seperti dia, pakar yang volunteer their time and effort to build up innovation in the form of a tax relief that could be confirmed through YIM.
Okay, saya faham. So pada saya, there's no problem at all about that suggestion. So the most important is that you need someone to bring that matter. But of course we understand that. Yeah. So you put out the next coming apa tadi this coming budget, because pada saya begini lah. If you want to get something, you have to spend something, you know, to forego something. Then nothing is free in this world. Nothing is free. Love also is not free love. You know, sometimes the love is very expensive. So saya rasa itu tak ada masalah. You tell him, it's no problem. But just put up itu. On our part, there's no problem. Yes, please.
I also know that Warren here from the Social Enterprise Alliance is also interested in a tax relief. If you want to say something, Warren.
Yeah. First of all, I'm from the Social Enterprise Alliance. Great talk, by the way. I recently started as CEO of my organization, so I felt that this was very relevant. So thank you to Azit as well for organizing this.
Thank you.
So what Azit is mentioning is that social enterprise has growingly been recognized as a very effective way to deal with social problems. And the most recent development would of course be in the global social business of the summit of last year. Our Prime Minister announced a $20 million fund specifically for social enterprise.
Okay.
So I guess on our side, what we would be interested in knowing is that since the government is now recognizing social enterprise as a positive cause, would there also be tax benefits that could follow along with this as well?
Yeah, I think there shouldn't be any problem. You put up the case, everything the Ministry of Finance will go through, you know. But as far as we are concerned, it's okay. We no objection at all. If everybody want to exempt the tax, we are free. We are happy. We are happy. You know why? Because I tell you that we got a lot more effort to do for other cases. No other guy. So I think okay, no problem. Yes, please.
Yes, I am Zahira from News
Media
Channel.
Zalira from Terra TV. I'm introducing a new TV channel in Astro. And this TV channel will be about Halal Lifestyle channel. And we plan to encourage SMEs, especially halal products, to advertise in our program. So our concept is we convert impulse to buy into sale. So they get instant immediate return on that investment on advertisement. But the thing is, there is no tax benefit for advertising and promotion right now. In fact, yesterday I was with Majlis Perundingan Melayu. We wanted to propose this, so today I meet you, the person as well. Yeah, that is one, to propose for advertising tax relief or something. And number two, I was inspired also with what you have achieved. I'd like to know, who inspired you to lead this change?
Who?
Yeah.
Yes, sebenarnya bila you kata who tu. Bila you kata who tu sebenarnya macam ni lah. When macam lagi tu. Actually, okay, it started way back in 1978. In 1978, when I was graduated from University of Malaya, I was with Point Bank. Those days are now it's a RSP lah. I went to Point Bank. A year later, I received a letter from JPA, okay, to offer me to join Jabatan Hasil. Eh. So they hantar saya to Melaka. So of course, as a Melaka kampung boy, want to balik kampung lah. Aku balik kampung. So then they started. Then I got apa tadi the offer is an attachment officer. Sedangkan bank I already confirm. And those days you tahu lah bank punya gaji tinggi. Compared to government now so tinggi kan? Okay. So they explain to me. They kata okay if you accept this post, the highest you can go pada masa tu they use the term of director general. You can go up to director general. Then from that day, I tell myself, I have a dream. If during school days, I can be the head boy. It's not impossible to me now. This post can lead me to the highest post. So what I did, I prepare myself. Prepare. But my journey is not smooth journey. Because toward the end, my boss try to potong sana, potong sini. No, because sometimes this is problem because bila boss you tak suka you lebih pandai daripada dia. This is the problem. Without referring to yang mati lah, yang hidup lah. Yeah, okay. I still alive. You know what, I agree daripada you. The problem is this, sepatutnya each everyone of us should act like a teacher. You remember that during our school days? Masa kita sekolah dulu. Apa cikgu kata? Murid-murid, cikgu nak masa besar besok jadi apa dia? Doktor, profesor, engineer, betul tak kan? Dia never say that jadi macam cikgu. Betul tak kan? So that's mean the cikgu want the student excel more than the cikgu. Tapi yang banyak berlaku dekat organisasi, bila jadi boss, dia try to suppress orang bawah. Because they thought that they are so powerful. This is not your company, man. If your company, fine. Because you pay your other salary. But now, your salary also being paid. Betul tak? So, bila you tanya siapa dia sebenarnya, my inner syukur. Yes, my inner syukur, really. That means, if I pernah menjadi apa head board, why not one final board? So, saya equip myself. Equip. I mix around with apa today my counterpart everything. And I tell you that you can ask apa tadi hasil it. I never change my style. Even though when I appointed as a CEO, why must I change? Nanti bila tukar orang yang marah siapa? Oh, syukur ni buku kawan aku sekarang tak nak kawan, betul tak kan? So why must I change? Unless if I cannot proceed, apa cannot perform my duty, then I have to change. So I need to beat myself, and I also to prove to the my ex boss that being a boss, you cannot detach yourself from the mainstream. Nampak tak? Ini apa analogi? Oh, if we are the boss, kita tak boleh nampak dengan orang bawah, nanti orang bijak. Mana boleh? Sekarang kita tengok Taska, kecil-kecil pun cikgu kata good boy, betul tak kan? Good girl, betul tak kan? Budak umur 2 tahun, budak umur 20 pun boleh rasa. Nampak tak? You boleh rasa antara bapak pegang dengan mak pegang. How do you know that? The baby can. Bila mak pegang, ada bumper.
Okay, we get a final couple of questions. Please, in the back of the line.
Okay.
Department ni, company ni being known that too many layer, betul kan? Too many layer. So to me, I break that layer. You can come straight to me. And I form a team. In lembaga, we form a team. They can email me, direct to me, then we discuss. Kenapa tak? Because to me it's very simple. Let listen from the people on the grounds. They know better about the problem. You know best about your policy. But whether your policy can be executed very well, only your people on the ground. So seperti saya kata, I'm not talking about a theory, but to me the most important tadi, get things done. Nampak kan? Kalau kita terlalu sangat cinta, oh, kalau macam ni, sometimes some bosses I came across, bila kita bagi cadangan je, oh ini I need a banker now tu. Jadi syndrome banker, syndrome appoint consultant. Never trust the internal expert. You trust, sorry to say lah, you know. But you have to trust first your internal expert know best. Know best. But the problem, because you don't give them due respect, of course consultant when come, oh sir, near, yes sir, yes sir. Oh, sir, 3 million. Nampak tak kan? Oh, you kata, memanglah saya bukan kata apa, one day also I can be a consultant. Nampak tak? But the first thing is, so pada saya puan, very simple. Nampak tak? If you want to make change, don't macam tadi dia kata, if not now, when? Nampak tak? Yeah? So, do it. Ya nak tunggu perfection, problem. Simple argument. Sekejap eh. Evaluation. Ni dalam government ni evaluation kan? Evaluation buat markah ni. I've gone through daripada when I started work. Those guys kalau you ingat eh, narrative. Bila narrative, you don't know which ayat is more better than much more powerful. Then, lepas tu, now kata pakai apa, mark. 1 to 2, this one, score. 3 to 4 macam ni. Dan lepas tu, boss pula kata, oh, I've been called out. Syukur, why you are so apa generous to your officer? Why you give 10? 10 is not, apa, we are not perfect, Syukur. I kata, man, we are not talking about perfection. We are talking about highest score. Betul tak kan? Highest mark. Bagi 10, dia kata, oh no no no, I think siapa bagi 10, you must put additional mark lah. Because we already transformed from narrative to the score. Now score 10, you taruh 10, nak tulis lagi remark. Why you apa he or she deserve for 10? Logik ke? Unless kalau you letak apa 11. Betul tak kan? Then you are so stupid. Then lepas tu finally apa jadi? Bila orang tak mau tulis apa tadi additional notes, they start to put the highest is 9. The highest is 9. So when someone give 10, masuk dalam komputer, siapa yang dapat? 10 is higher than 9. Inilah masalah kita. Bila nak buat, oh, nanti apa orang kata, oh, nanti apa orang kata. Padahal dia tak buat tu berapa, banyak orang kata dia. Let's do it. Nampak tak? Of course, nothing is free. Okay, never give up. Nampak tak? Saya, 11,000, kalau you buat mungkin, memang tak dapat 100%. Kita ada satu kajian orang buat, 97%, tak apa. Saya tunjukkan, 97% okey mak, 3% je mangkuk air, okey. Why must I worry about that? I must jaga for the majority. This is the problem, when the minority try to supersede the majority. Nampak tak? Of course, fine, we respect the right as individual, but the right of individual, there is limit in the sense that if I exercise my right, not in the expense of your right. Am I right? Nampak tak? Then fair balancing eh? So, jangan itulah. Eh, cakap semangat.
Okay, Azif. Okay, ladies and gentlemen. I know there's many, many more questions. But Tansri will be available sambil-sambil kita minum-minum teh tarik. There's a couple of other things we need to do. But at the moment, we're going to invite Tansri and members of the media to our boardroom for a short question and answer session with the media. In the meantime, we are all free to mingle and have enjoy your teh tarik. One more big round of applause for Tansri.
Thank you so much. Thank you, thank you.
Empat orang very lucky winners. Tanpa membuang masa, Encik Aziz is already here. Saya ingin menjemput pemenang. Pemenang dari minggu ke-6 dipersilakan Encik Nur Faizal bin Haji Iyad. Which is a software designed to expedite the process of capturing MyCard data with a low cost of ownership. It can be used to accurately identify details embedded on the MyCard smart chip, categorize details for easy identification for governmental services, border control, electronic payments, and the other. You invent something yang supaya kita tak payah bayar tax. That bagi you. Okay, from week 7, I would like to invite and check Ku Adi Fazli dan Ku Radin. He invented something really awesome. How many of you have tested the pizza?
Yeah.
Rasa? Saya tak rasa. Tak sampai kat saya. He invented the Pizzalicious vending machine. Okay,
other good speakers. Just for your information, the Teh Tarik talk happens every month, every third Friday of the month. So thank you, and please enjoy the Teh Tarik and have fun. Happy weekend. Bye bye. Thank you.
Teh Tarik talk.